Please join me in our opening sentences and the prayer of the day. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall proclaim your praise. Let us hear what the Lord will speak. God will speak peace to the faithful. Grant us, O Lord, the grace always to do and think what accords with your purpose, that we who cannot exist without you may be enabled to live according to your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please join me in our thanksgiving for baptism. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Gracious God, we give you thanks that through the gift of our baptism, you have embraced us as your own and make us one in Christ's body. By the power of the Holy Spirit, continue to nourish and strengthen us in the ways of faith, hope, and love. Through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. My siblings in Christ, remember your baptism in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, knowing that you are the children of God, now and forever. The peace of Christ be with you all. Please join me in our morning psalm, Psalm 105, verses 1 through 6 and 16 through 22. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon the divine name. Make known the deeds of the Lord among the peoples. Sing to the Lord, sing praises, and speak of all the marvelous works of the Lord. Glory in the holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Search for the strength of the Lord. Continually seek the face of God. Remember the marvels the Lord has done, the wonders and the judgments of the mouth of the Lord. O offspring of Abraham, the servant of God, O children of Jacob, the chosen of the Lord. Then God called for a famine in the land and destroyed the supply of bread. The Lord sent a man before them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. They bruised his feet in fetters, his neck they put in an iron collar. Until his prediction came to pass, the word of the Lord tested him. The king sent and released him. The ruler of the peoples set him free. He set him as a master over his household, as a ruler over all his possessions, to instruct his princes according to his will, and to teach his elders wisdom.
everybody. So happy to be with you this morning. Rilley and I want to talk to you about generosity. And that can seem like a big word, but we're here to break it down for you. Generosity is just giving to others. Rilley, what are some ways that you like to be generous?
Yeah, so I might be generous by offering someone a piece of gum. So I might say, hey, Cannon, would you like a piece of gum today?
I love gum. Thank you so much, Rilley. I would love a piece of gum.
Small act of generosity.
But it doesn't always have to be things that you give. You can also give your time. For example, there is a food shelter in Waukesha where you can donate your time to help make meals for people who don't already have them.
Mm-hmm. One way I might donate my time too, if I know a friend is having trouble with a math problem, help them out. Help them do their homework a little bit.
Exactly. So we want you to take a pause, maybe turn to your parents or a friend next to you, and think of some of the ways that you like to be generous in your life.
Ready? Go. I'll give a little bit. Welcome back, everyone. Hopefully you were able to come up with some ways that you can be generous. What we want to talk about next is how to be generous even when you're having a really bad day. So say first you stubbed your toe.
Oh.
Run out of your favorite cereal. Slip on a banana peel and then spill your milk. You're probably gonna be in a pretty crummy mood.
But sometimes, when you're in that bad mood, that's the best time to be generous.
Hello. Can I help you with that? Thank you.
So by helping a friend, it made their day feel better, and it made my day feel better.
And always remember, if someone is generous to you, make sure you say thank you.
All right, we're going to close with a small prayer. Dear God, all that we have is yours, O Lord, and we follow your generous lead. May all people see your love when they receive the blessings of your gifts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Our Bible reading today is from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 15. And today, this finishes our series on 2 Corinthians. Paul writes, "Brothers and sisters, we want to let you know about the grace of God that was given to the churches of Macedonia. While they were being tested by many problems, their extra amount of happiness and their extreme poverty resulted in a surplus of rich generosity. I assure you that they gave what they could afford and even more than they could afford, and they did it voluntarily. They urgently begged us for the privilege of sharing in this service for the saints. They even exceeded our expectations because they gave themselves to the Lord first and to us, consistent with God's will. As a result, we challenged Titus to finish this work of grace with you that he had started it. Be the best in this work of grace in the same way that you are the best in everything, such as faith, speech, commitment, total commitment, and the love we inspired in you. I'm not giving you an order, but by mentioning the commitment of others, I'm trying to prove the authenticity of your love also. You know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Although he was rich, he became poor for your sakes, so that you could become rich through his poverty. I'm giving you my opinion about this. It's to your advantage to do this, since you not only started to do it last year, but you wanted to do it too. Now finish the job as well, so that you finish it with as much enthusiasm as you started, given what you can afford. A gift is appreciated because of what a person can afford, not because of what that person can't afford if it's apparent that it's done willingly. It isn't that we want others to have financial ease and you financial difficulties, but it's a matter of equality. At the present moment, your surplus can fill their deficit so that in their future, their surplus can fill your deficit. In this way, there is equality. As it is written, the one who gathered more didn't have too much, and the one who gathered less didn't have too little. Holy wisdom, holy word, thanks be to God. I'm very thankful to Cannon and Rilley for their children's lesson because it makes this conversation a little more easier. When Paul is writing to this church in Corinth, it is a church that is made up of Gentiles, non-Jews that converted to Christianity. And as we read in 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, and actually any time Paul wrote a letter, it was because there was some sort of conflict in the church. And so it is with this church in Corinth, as it struggles to be a witness, the body of Christ, in that moment, in that time, in that setting of Corinth, a metropolitan, a very worldly and international city. We also hear within this second letter of Corinthians that the conflict that has been in the body has bubbled out, and that those that were against Paul or sowed the seeds of divisiveness in the society, in the culture, in the church itself, were excommunicated, they were disciplined. But Paul is asking for the Corinthian church to be a little more grace-filled, more loving, more forgiving, and to reconcile, find the ways, the pathways to reconcile with each other so that they may be more focused. Focused not so much on the conflict and the subjects of the conflict, but that they may be unified, that they may be the body of Christ, a presence of Christ in Corinth. We also hear in the second letter to the Corinthians, the church there in Corinth, that no one is Christ per se. All of us are very fragile clay jars. And in it, the Holy Spirit dwells in us and provides for us the gifts of the Spirit, the opportunity to be the presence of Christ in the world. And no one should be put up on a pedestal, and no one should be put down lower. That we're all called to be bound to each other. That in the celebration of one, we all celebrate, and in the grief of one, we all grieve. Paul is really pulling together these threads of the ontological or the nature of what it means to be the church. That it is not no one person is the church. The church is only in its fullest, and it's only in the most incarnational presence of Christ when we live together and work together towards this ministry of reconciliation, as Paul writes. So today, Paul writes about generosity and about the work of an apostolic leader. All of us, as we are baptized members of this church, all of us are called to lead in this ministry of the gospel and the ministry of generosity. We have generosity, we give generosity, or generously, because God gives generously. It is an act of love, and out of that act of love, we are able to provide for others when they are in need. When Paul writes this letter to the church in Corinth, there is a great tragedy, devastation in the city of Jerusalem. All of those that are Jewish Christians, and even those that are Jewish, Paul is calling them, all the other Gentile churches around in the area, to help provide for the food, the clothing, the nurture, the medical needs of their brothers and sisters in Jerusalem. And he says that it comes back to this whole nature that we're all interconnected with each other. We are bound to one another. So that this church in Corinth that has had this great conflict, they've done pretty well. They've been raising funds. They're great at fundraising. And since they're Gentiles, they probably, in a very wealthy city, they have done pretty well. But Paul is reminding them that they probably should not hoard the gifts that God has given them. He reminds them of the church in Macedonia, that in Macedonia, and I think Paul is kind of poking them, the church in Corinth at this point, that Paul is telling them that the Macedonians are poor, but out of their poverty, they have been able to amass a great offering to help those in Jerusalem. And so the church in Corinth has started a fundraiser a long time ago, and Paul is calling them to wrap it up and fulfill what they have promised. Because out of the generosity of God, they have been given many gifts. That gifts that are of time, talent, and treasures, and resources, and that they need to fulfill the vows that they promised. To say that they truly are one with the people in Jerusalem. So, church in Corinth, wrap up the fundraiser and send the check. The takeaway for us all is that it's not about money. It's about a spirit of generosity that comes when we follow Jesus Christ. Because Jesus, the Son of God, came to us, descended from being with God in heaven, came to us, humbled himself in human form, and gave his life for us, rose from the dead for us, so that we may have life in all of its ways. Have life mentally, life physically, life in abundance, that we have the necessities that we need to survive. Roof, housing, shelter, food, water, love. We all need love to survive. But not only survive, but to thrive and to flourish. And so by supporting fellow children of God, brothers and sisters in Christ, the church in Corinth was called to be Christ in a way to those in Jerusalem that needed their help. As we think about our baptismal vows and the way of living the life in Christ, we're called not only to believe in Christ and in statements of faith that have been summed up in like the Apostles and Nicene Creed. It's more than just up here. It's here. And it's more than just feelings. It's about actions. As Christians, as disciples of Jesus Christ, we are called to be a faith in action. A faith in action that is bold, a faith in action that is very generous, as it shares the love and grace of Jesus Christ in this world. So in this time of a pandemic, where there are many needs, where there is unemployment rising around us, such as here in Waukesha, it's up to 12% unemployment, and in Milwaukee in the county area, it's even higher. In places where there are people that are unable to, at this time, provide food for their children, shelter, or even if they have children going back to school physically or even online, but they're not able to afford internet connections. Think about the ways that God has blessed you in this moment and in this time. How are you being called to be generous with this love and this grace that God has given you, the gifts that God has given you? Everything you have is because God has given it to you. How are you being called to share from the gifts that God has given you? I'll wrap up with just a brief sharing. Karen and I right now, we are watching a lot of shows on television as we are hunkering down and staying more at home, especially at staycations and such. And we really like BritBox and Acorn and the BBC shows. But we right now we're watching a show from Australia called 800 Words. In the show, the main character, George, has just tragically lost his wife and watched her death as she is run over in the street. And it has pained him. It has pierced his soul. He is grieving deeply. And so are his two children, a son and a daughter. He makes a bold move that in his grief that he needs to make some changes. And in that change, he decides to move from Sydney, Australia to New Zealand, to this really small town called Rilley. And the series is basically about the experience of the family as they integrate into this New Zealand life and become part of the community. At the end of season one, George is struggling because his daughter did not acclimate well to moving from Sydney, a metropolis, to this little small city, town, village on the island of New Zealand. And she steals his credit card and she buys a plane ticket to fly back to Sydney and to stay with her grandparents. And George is just overwhelmed with grief in so many different ways. It's another loss. It's a loss on top of a loss on top of a loss, and the struggles and the stress of moving his children, which he thought was a good thing to make a new start, is turning out to be not so good. There's a scene where he is standing on the beach. He is thinking about getting out into the surf because it's kind of a way to relieve stress, to think, to meditate, to recreate. He's there standing with his surfboard, looking at the waves and how much he's not really a good surfer, and thinking about everything that is on his shoulders. And you can see the tears welling in his eyes. And then comes the series, what I call the wise fool, Woody, who is the handyman and friend of George, and he comes up and he's talking to George about installing their new oven in their shack there in the village. And George then is talking about everything else going on in his life, and Woody says, "George, it's just a hob, it's just a range, but here it is. Think about your life, George, and everything that you've been giving, and every opportunity. Think about the moment that you're standing here on this beach, looking out in that ocean, and surrounded by this beauty. And there are billions of people that would give anything to be where you are right now. All of us, if we look around, can see the abundance of God's grace and love and the gift that we have been given. I'm sitting in the garden here at the manse, surrounded by the dogs that are trying to get me to play. This is a great gift. And this is a moment of recreation and a moment of recentering and a moment to really see how good God is, and to assess the gifts that I've been given so that I may give life and share life with others. Even if I don't have much, God has given me enough that I can share with others." Friends, Christ gave his life for you. May you give life to others out of the abundance of gifts that God has given you. All praise, honor, and glory be to you, O God, now and forever. Amen. All right, Tig, bring that stick over.
Friends, hear this invitation. Even the smallest inclination toward generosity saves lives. Out of even the smallest expression of generosity, God brings about great and mighty results. Out of our gifts, no matter how small, God yields an abundant harvest of joy and hope for each person touched by the ministry of this church. Let us then gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and praise. Please join me in our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. Satisfy us with your love in the morning, and we will live this day in joy and praise. God of all mercies, we praise you that you have brought us to this day, brightening our lives with the dawn of promise and hope in Jesus Christ. Especially we thank you for ministries of discernment and governance, those who teach and those who learn, the community of faith in your church, reconciliation in our relationships, all gifts of healing and forgiveness. Merciful God, strengthen us in prayer that we may lift up the brokenness of this world for your healing and share in the saving love of Jesus Christ. Especially we pray for the church in Europe, safe, clean, and renewable energy, those who are lonely and forgotten, those from whom we are estranged, all who glorify you in worship and service. Eternal God, you are the source of every gift and the fountain of all blessing. Give us such joy in living and such peace in serving Christ that we may gratefully make use of all your blessings and joyfully seek our risen Lord in everyone we meet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now, as your priestly people, we raise up all the prayers that are on our hearts and the prayers of all creation, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, as you go out to live your life this week, know that everything that you need, God has given you, including sticks. So go out knowing that, go out joyfully knowing that the love of the Father is yours now and forever, and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ is yours now and forever, and the communion of the Holy Spirit is yours now and forever. Nothing can ever take this from you, not even death. Hallelujah. Amen. I'll see you guys next week.